Hello, Ronnie Scott's Club. Yes, we're open tonight. What time do we open? Well, what time can you get here? No, you can wear what you like. Just wear a tie. Nothing else, just a tie. Okay, bye-bye.
As I listened to the sweet and soothing sound, I once again reflected, thank the Lord I was born into the jazz age. What on earth could it have been when all they had to listen to was ballad tunes and waltzes? Because jazz music is a thing that, as few things do, makes you feel really at home in the world here, as if it's an okay notion to be born a human animal. Colin McKinney's nameless narrator in Absolute Beginners, explaining why jazz was crucial to his education. McKinney's cult novel of the late 50s also describes Soho, which he loved as much as jazz, with the words, all the things they say happen, do. Optimistic teenagers have been making the weekend pilgrimage up west since the notion of teenagers was invented, hoping it was all true. Converging on the centre from the asteroid belt of Southgate or Purley, hoping to live your life in one night. Of course, Soho didn't give you everything, but it promised a lot. It seemed to say that you could leave behind the person you were supposed to be in the suburbs and start again in another dimension. And in a lot of cases, you might well have been taken on that escape route by some of the most exciting sounds of the 20th century, the sounds of jazz.
Admired Ronnie for what he's done and been very thankful for the sake of British jazz and for world jazz that he's done it, because if you mention jazz to any American anywhere, any jazz fan anywhere in the United States or Australia, New Zealand, Hong Kong, if you like, perhaps the first thing they'll make an effort at connecting with you if you say you're from England, or if they know you're from the United Kingdom, they say, ah, I've been to Ronnie Scott's, or I've heard of Ronnie Scott's. I mean, it's synonymous with jazz in this country.
Politicians lead the life of nightclub pianists, I always think, in terms of hours. I mean, we tend to work late into the night, and the voting is usually late at night, the house sits at night. You've got to be a bit of a late-night person to be a politician. If you get relaxation out of jazz, if you get excitement out of jazz, if you can switch off and concentrate on jazz after a day on quite different things, then this is the place to come.
It's coming home. It's a little nest of happiness. It's good sounds, sounds that heal. All the recent wounds are all healed here at Ronnie Scott's, because there's always somebody blowing something beautiful and talking the kind of unconscious poetry that only good music can speak to you.
Mm-hmm.
Capturing the bird in flight. This time, the Chicago saxophonist Johnny Griffin is caught by the lens of David Redfern, whose images you see all over the club. The visual history of this place called Ronnie's.
There will be other lips that I may kiss. They won't thrill me like yours used to do. Say I may dream a million dreams, but how can they come true if there will never ever be another you?
Never go back to Georgia, 'cause I like London.
Scott.
I remember that one very well because I went by the club and I was coming down those steps and fell, man, on the iron steps. I hurt my leg. I was mad with Ronnie Scott ever since. And I know he's a very good close friend and he's funny too. But Ronnie has done a tremendous job about the promulgation of our music. He's always had somebody in there, some of the younger guys, the older guys, and he plays there. Ronnie does a terrific job for the club.
Frith Street, Soho. Ronnie Scott's isn't the hole in the wall it used to be, but a big, sophisticated West End nightclub, dependent now on lucrative passing trade as well as hardcore jazz fans. The one thing that hasn't changed in 30 years is that Scott himself, armed with a tenor saxophone and a wisecrack, is still earning his keep.
Thank you very much and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the quintet, that's Dick Pierce on the trumpet and flugelhorn, Martin Drew on the drums, Ron Matheson on the bass, John Crittins on the piano, and myself. Five musicians brought a great deal of pleasure to very few people. And that one was for a gentleman who asked for the Yellow Rose of Texas. But I hope you enjoyed that because it does have a lot of the same notes in it. A little touch of humour there. I come from a very poor family in the East End of London. We really were desperately poor. Had to buy all our clothes at a war surplus store. And let me tell you, it was no fun for a nine-year-old Jewish kid to have to go to school in the East End wearing a Japanese admiral's uniform.
Ronnie Scott was born Ronald Schatt in Aldgate in 1927. Via the traditional route of Jewish youth clubs, weddings and bar mitzvahs, the young Ronnie learned the ways of musicians.
My first saxophone lessons were from a guy called Jack Lewis, who was an old retired dance band saxophone player. And he had a son called Harry Lewis, who was a professional saxophone player, who ended up marrying Vera Lynn. And so that's my claim to fame. I took lessons from Vera Lynn's father-in-law. The first instrument I ever bought was a cornet, which I bought on from an antique shop. And then I got a very old soprano saxophone. I mean, a really old one with a double octave key. The double octave key went out in about 1827. I thought, God, this is difficult. And then my parents saw that I was serious about trying to play something, and they bought me a tenor saxophone.
Ronnie Scott and his friends hung out with all the professional musicians they could, hoping for the big break.
Well, the first job I got, I think, in one of those places was at a place called the Jamboree, and Carlo Kramer was the band leader, and he had a very good band there. And as I remember, the tenor saxophone player in the band was leaving, and his replacement couldn't start for 2 or 3 weeks. And Carlo asked me if I'd fill in for those 2 or 3 weeks. And I told him, look, I've only been playing a year or 18 months or whatever it was. I was about 16, 17 years old. And he said, well, it doesn't matter. I'm contracted to present 6 musicians on the bandstand. All you've got to do is sit there. So that's what I did for 2 or 3 weeks, virtually just miming. Carlo was a great collector and a very knowledgeable musician, and he had one room which was lined with records, and we used to go round there occasionally and listen to the latest imports which he managed to get. And that was the first time I heard Charlie Parker play. I'd heard of Charlie Parker. Red Cross, I think, was the name of the track, as I remember. Just seemed to be the right contemporary way to play, you know. It's very difficult to put into words, but it turned us all around.
Charlie Parker and the new jazz became a symbol of protest for an entire generation. For a lot of young Britons, Parker's music seemed to be a vision of the future. But at the same time, it could only be experienced through records. Though his particular fire sprang directly from the beleaguered black American culture that had spawned jazz, Parker appealed to outsiders everywhere. The hipster was born, embracing bebop culture as an antidote to the elitism of European high art and the often maudlin pop music of the day.
Well, I suppose we were always...
Here are 3 hipsters, part of Ronnie Scott's circle, whose lives were changed by Charlie Parker.
Don't forget that when bebop came out, the Melody Makers' chief critic, Edgar Jackson, said, this is a load of rubbish. Charlie Parker can't play his instrument. This isn't modern harmony, it's wrong notes. And so he damned it right from the off.
That's true, yeah, he did.
And so because it was damned in the eyes of the musical establishment, because we were trying to play this, we were unemployable.
That's right.
I mean, this is why we had to form our own scene.
That's right.
Still are.
I think what had happened was we'd recognised a language, a musical language, that was for our time. That was our time. And we just took to it like that. And that's why I say when I first heard Ronnie, you know, Ronnie was always playing. He was always playing that way. Not exactly bebop, but that was the road it was going down. And he had the technique and the power to play it. There's never any question of being a kind of player now and then a different player. It just grew, didn't it? Just went on. It was the same for all of us.
And it wasn't just in music. I mean, the same thing happened in in art. When you look at the Jackson Pollocks and the Mark Rothkos and those kind of people who broke away from the previous static forms of painting, they went on a similar path. I suppose the war must have been the big catalyst, really.
Well,
for the
war always creates a revolution.
Well, it smashed all the existing values, and they all went out the window.
The union ban meant that you couldn't hear American artists like Parker or Lester Young or Billie Holiday in the flesh. But if you couldn't raise the fare to the States but knew your way around a dance band songbook, one way was to get signed up for what was affectionately known as Giraldo's Navy, the orchestras that entertained transatlantic passengers. It may not have meant playing the music you dreamed of, but it took you to the holy grail of New York's jazz clubland, 52nd Street.
The boat docked at Pier 90, I think it was, which was right virtually at 52nd Street. So we get off the boat, down the gangway, and then look up, and on the lamppost, you know, those famous lamppost signs, it said 52nd Street. We thought, what? The little brownstone buildings all had cellars and basements, and they were all clubs on either side of the road. And outside each club, there was a doorman, with his hat and uniform, looking a bit tacky, I suppose, but saying, come on, fellas, now, Lady Day, just going on. Another one was saying, come on, Dizzy's Big Band, just going on, fellas. No cover charts, no minimum. It was just like fairyland. All these people that you always wanted to hear all your life, and you had to choose which one. You couldn't hear them all at the same time.
To the young jazz tourists, New York meant cliff-hanging music, unrationed luxuries, hip fashions, and the feeling that the distance between dreams and fulfillment was shorter than it was in London. When they came back, it seemed to be to a community of musicians that was stuck in the past. They met, gossiped, and exchanged work, commercial work, not jazz, in Archer Street off Piccadilly, an open-air job centre. The young players tried to create their own world for their own music, like the short-lived Club 11 at the beginning of the 1950s. Throughout that decade, adventurous jazz and dance band music lived uneasily side by side. But the beboppers began to win a new audience. Ronnie Scott, by this time the most highly regarded saxophonist in Britain, started to lead successful bands of his own, over the years steadily reducing the proportion of schmaltz required to get work. In 1957, he formed an all-out jazz band, the Jazz Couriers, with the prodigious young saxophonist, Tubby Hayes. When the Couriers folded, Scott and an old playing partner, Pete King, teamed up again, this time not for a band, but for an old Scott dream of home.
The club was never intended to be what it's turned out to be. It was somewhere for us to try and improve and try and develop our music, because what we were doing, we were earning a living playing in dance bands, but we really didn't get a chance to play. And it was really getting the chance to play and maybe have a decent piano and a microphone and maybe a light or something, and that's all we really set out to do.
October 30th, 1959, Ronnie Scott's club opened in a basement in Gerrard Street in the heart of Chinatown, where the strongest drink was stewed tea, the dressing room was a cubbyhole under the street, and the attractions were strictly local musicians.
This is the site of the first club, and what a site it is. Yeah, it was 39 Gerrard. We had kind of a Heath Robinson awning that went up and covered the stairs, because we had to roll up and take away every night. Amazing. This used to be a taxi driver's all-night hangout thing, a little coffee bar, and guys used to come down and play cards, the cab drivers. And I think, as I remember, on Sunday afternoons they used to run some things.
Yeah, they used to run a thing, and Saturday nights.
And Saturday nights, yeah. And the landlord, a guy named Jack Forder, was an ex-cab driver, wasn't doing very well at the place, and he asked us if we'd like to take it over full-time, which we did, and paid the rent, which was something like, I don't know, £12 a week, something like that.
How did you furnish the place the first time around?
Very sparsely, if I remember correctly. Just chairs and
Pete and I went down the East End, to a wholesale kind of furniture manufacturer and bought, I don't know, 50 or 60 chairs. And we hired a piano, I think.
Yeah, we did. Yeah.
Hired a piano.
Had trouble getting the piano downstairs.
Yeah. And, sorry. 2 and 6 all night, and we hired some sound equipment and painted everything white. Everything in sight was painted white, and we opened. Went from there.
At its gayest and brightest, the West End has the relook of Christmas. Movies, theatres, restaurants do their part to see that a good time will be had by all. So why should anyone worry? Certainly nothing disturbs the minds of the happy folk who are starting out on a jolly evening. But only a stone's throw from the bright lights, it's a different story. This is Soho, catering for all tastes, low included.
You have to remember in those days, the situation of jazz musicians was a parlous one. You could play jazz, but you had to work for people that, they called themselves jazz club proprietors. What they really were petty felons, most of them. And they would hire a room and hire some musicians and give them at least threepence each and then pocket the proceeds. There were nothing to do with music, these people. If they were going to sell music because it made money, that's all. So when Ronnie finally formed a club, it was a revolutionary thing to do, because there'd never been a club where, when you went to work, you were working for one of the fellas. There'd never been that, ever. Not in the history of British music.
From 1959 to 1961, Ronnie Scott's club served the local jazz scene. But eventually, to cover the rent, the club began to need stars with more rarity value, which at that time meant Americans. Union regulations about foreign players were still the stumbling block, but Pete King eventually broke the impasse, bringing in Zoot Sims, one of the most relaxed and elegant members of the 1940s Woody Herman Band, to be the first of a dazzling list.
Apart from it being an education for everybody, it was somehow a kind of accolade for the club. It made the club a much more serious business. This was still in Gerrard Street, where it was still a sort of very pokey little hole. And I remember, I mean, how insufferable people are. He brought down Zoot Sims, Ben Webster, Sonny Stan gets everybody. And there were complaints.
Why do you only bring saxophone players down?
Why have you got this policy? And Ronnie said, look, you go to your club and invite a new one. I mean, in the meantime, the parade of the world's greatest saxophone players were being paraded through Gerrard Street for our benefit. It was a fantastic business. It made the club something very much more than a local parochial thing. It put it on a European and eventually the world map. The first group as such that we had was the Bill Evans Trio. Yeah, when Bill arrived, well, before Bill arrived, we decided that the piano we had wasn't good enough for Bill Evans, so we sold it, I think, just a couple of days before he was due to arrive, with the idea of hiring a piano from a firm that was in the vicinity. And we arranged a week beforehand what piano we wanted, and they arranged that they were going to deliver it and so on. And then a representative came down from this piano hiring place and took a look at the premises and said, well, this is the day before Bill Evans is due to open, and we got no piano. And he said, well, no, I'm sorry, we can't hire you a piano. I said, well, why not? Well, first of all, if you take it down the stairs, it's liable to get damaged. And then I didn't know it was a jazz club, and I think he had visions of people pouring beer into the piano and girls lying on it. I don't know what he thought would happen to it. And finally, I remember Pete saying to him, look, bugger off, or words to that effect, you know. But in the end, we managed to find a piano belonging to someone or other, a nice grand piano. But, I mean, it was a very last-minute thing. I was just wondering what the Bill Evans Trio were going to do without a piano. Maybe Bill would dance or sing or something.
In those early days, most of the American soloists came alone and needed local accompaniment. For 7 years, the house pianist at Ronnie Scott's was Stan Tracy, a gifted improviser and composer in his own right.
It's a string gun.
He just tuned it.
That's old Pete. Oh,
just like the old days, then.
Just like the old days.
What is it like working in here these days?
I cannot tell a lie. I prefer working in the old place. For me, it was more adventurous. I suppose it had to be because the whole situation was new, working with those guys. And the whole atmosphere was different.
Which of those players did you feel happiest with?
Well, there were several I felt very happy with, but the one that stands out above all the others for me was Sonny Rollins, for his inventiveness, you know, night after night. Tremendous. You never really knew what to expect. For instance, there was one night we played Three Little Words for the first set complete, about an hour. Had a break, he came back on and played Three Little Words for an hour. And there was so much invention going on that it really didn't matter. It was quite a fantastic experience.
That was my first experience in England, playing at Ronnie Scott's. Actually, if you recall, the club at that time was on Gerrard Street. And it was in the basement, so it was very similar to a lot of clubs in New York in a way that are done in the basement, you know. So physically, it was pretty much like a lot of jazz clubs, you know. Comparatively small, crowded, you know, and the cigarette smoke and all of this stuff, you know. So it was, I felt quite at home there, actually.
Stan Tracy tells a story of the first rehearsal he remembers with you, when you came in and the band was waiting there, and you asked for Prelude to a Kiss, I think. And as Stan remembers it, you played it all afternoon and then never asked for it at any point on any of the shows. Is that the way you quite often rehearse with an unfamiliar band?
Well, it's possible, because I was probably trying to hear the band and let them hear me and sort of get an idea of my approach more so than an actual songs that we would play, because, of course, I like to play in a spontaneous manner, so it's possible that we did that, yeah. People there during our engagement. It was really packed every night. And, you know, when you play music into a club, you know, the music stays in the walls. And when you walk in there, you can feel some of the music that's been played there for all these years ago. So, that night, even though we had stopped playing, the music was still there. Everything was still there. You could feel it all there, you know. So I asked Ronnie and Pete, I said, look, let me stay down here and I'm going to write some music. I'll be quiet, won't be anybody here, and I can work, and the atmosphere is perfect. So I said, okay, and yeah, everybody went home and locked the doors, and most of the score and the sketching for Alfie was done right in the club.
Jazz musicians, do they all inhabit another galaxy? He seems to have a little trouble making contact with life as we know it on the planet Earth. I guess he's got tunes going on in his head all the time. Conversation comes second. That's why he talks in quotations a lot of the time. We all do. All our best lines are nicked from Duke Ellington or Ronnie Scott. Have a nice life is Ronnie's. Love you madly is the Duke's. Music's the real way of speaking. All the rest is just filling in time between gigs. And that's jazz. Mysterioso is my first proper grown-up novel. It's also the title of a piece of music by Thelonious Monk. The novel deals in part with jazz and jazz clubs and that kind of ambience. And what I've tried to do in writing about jazz is to try to crack the riddle of what happens and why. Because I think jazz musicians are light writers in the sense that you don't actually choose to be one, it chooses you. And having been chosen, you don't really have too much choice. I think the other thing we have in common is that we are confronted with the equivalent of blank sheet of paper. In our case, in a writer's case, a real blank sheet of paper. And what I know is I'm going to write a scene or a group of scenes, and I know there is a theme which you're going to carry out and which you're going to develop over 32 bars, let us say. But I don't know what the notes are. And I'd sit at the typewriter and I'd play the notes that develop that theme. And as Lester Young said, it's about telling a story.
In 1965, the club moved to the current plusher and bigger premises in Frith Street.
Gerald's just became too small, you know, if we wanted to do anything at all ambitious. I mean, Gerald Street was the kind of place that you had to pack the place every night to pay the rent. And very often we were packed and still didn't pay the rent. So we had to move to somewhere bigger. But the night we opened, I remember there was no electricity, or very little electricity. I mean, only a few things were connected, like the amplification was connected, and that was about all. We had candles.
Candles, yeah.
On all the tables.
Wires were hanging down all over the place. It's amazing, GLC then passed us to allow us to open, actually.
Yeah. And there was no distinction between the gents and the ladies' toilets. I mean, it was very bohemian, you know, it was really very French. But people took it very well, you know, and it worked. Yusuf Lateef and Ernestine Anderson
we opened with. Yeah,
great,
that's right.
Great music.
Yeah, yeah, very good.
When Buddy Rich came down, you were undergoing some more building work. What happened then?
We took on the extra part of the club as it is now. Buddy's band opened, and I mean, remember Howard coming down a couple of days prior to it saying, oh, God, we've got to cancel. You'll never be open in time, you know.
And I remember Buddy saying on the microphone when he opened that it's the first time he'd ever worked in a garage.
In a condemned building.
A condemned building.
Put the lights on. All right, press that. Here we go.
Believe it or not, ladies and Jews, he's here. The comic of the century, the legendary, yes, Mel Brooks. Yes, I'm here at Ronnie Scott's because he promised 10 visits here for nothing if I do this cockamamie show.
You were a drummer.
I was a drummer before I was a comic.
Right. And, how did you first hear about it?
I first heard noise coming out of a window in Brighton Court. Brighton Court, you say? No, not Brighton by the sea. Not Brighton Pavilion Furniture. Brighton, Jews, Coney Island, Brooklyn, Brighton Beach. There was a lot of noise coming out of a window. I was walking past with my friend Bobby. So we looked in the window, and there was this Jewish aborigine at the drums, sweat flying, sticks going. It was maybe the greatest hour of my life. But Ronnie Scott's, he was great here. This is a great room for him. He heard himself properly, you know? And he could do very pretty things here. And he didn't have to be too loud, you know? This is a great place for Buddy to play.
You made a movie in The Producers, which is about a couple of bad businessmen trying to be good businessmen by a roundabout route. Do you think... I mean, Ronnie's often said...
You think that's what Ronnie's doing?
Well, he's often said...
He's making money on his taxes?
I don't think it's like that. He says it would be a disadvantage to be a good businessman if you were going to go into the jazz business. You would never do it. If you knew about business, you wouldn't bother with this.
You couldn't break even, right? Never. You'd never be able to pay the musicians, the help at the bar, the people who clean up at night, the waiters, the busboys, the waitress. You can't because you can't ask them to pay enough money to cover your nut. Ever. You can't do it. I mean, you know, it's a losing proposition. Ronnie lives for jazz. He lives for the sound of horns and glissandos on keyboards. And I mean, he lives for that. I mean, he's like I am. I mean, he's a Jew freak who cannot live without great jazz music, you know.
Good afternoon, Ronnie Scott.
The club is the most peculiar thing. When you're running a club for music and not for money, you don't set any budgets like normal, sensible businessmen would do. You just go ahead and do a thing, and somehow or other you hope it's going to work, you know. And there were times when you thought, oh, good Lord, I think we might have cracked it this time. And no sooner you think that up. And about 6 or so years ago, we'd gotten very behind with the VAT, the PAYE and things like that, and it looked as though we were going to have to pack it in. I remember when the chain were going to go on the door and the accountant turned around to Ronnie and we were having this sort of final crunch meeting, and the accountant said, look, you've got to stop. And Ronnie looked at me and said, well, do we stop now? What do we do, Pete? And I don't know whether it was the horror of not knowing what was going to happen, it was too late, or the self-greed or whatever it was that made me say it, or it was just a kind of a gut feeling. I said, look, Ron, we can't stop. We've got to go on. And Ronnie just looked at the accountant and said, no, we're going on.
So some of the people who came into the club, they were part of the underworld fraternity of this district during the years, including Albert Dimes.
Well, Albert Dimes was the kind of godfather at that time. And I knew him simply because he was a friend of my father's, and they used to go racing together, you know. And when we opened here, he bought us a magnum of champagne. It was in 1965. He bought us a magnum of champagne over there. And he said, when you're out of debt, open the bottle. You know, it's still unopened, you know. So I think we may open it shortly, or auction it at Sotheby's, or just keep it. I think we'll just keep it.
If you're in the jazz business, you're not going to be a rich man. You know, that's not the point of the exercise. They used to say, you know, if the musicians had spent the same amount of energy and time and study and application studying accountancy, they'd all be millionaires, which I think is probably true. You know, there's no more dedicated or hard-working person, really, although they'd often deny that. They're the only idealists I've ever come across as Adams. You know, I know all kinds of writers and actors and politicians. I only ever met idealists in the jazz world, nowhere else.
Oh, quite good. Thank you, Prime Minister. So shall we press on with the affairs of the nation?
Stuff the affairs of the nation. I want to cook.
In the meantime, Malcolm Warren from the press office would like a word.
All right, bring him in.
Good afternoon, Prime Minister.
Oh, good afternoon, Malcolm. I'm expecting the Cabinet Secretary at any moment, so couldn't keep this brief.
I try to keep up to date, but I'm afraid my present job is interfering with that. I've become a less regular attender at Ronnie's in the last 12 months than I've ever been, I should think. Once I've got the health service sorted out, I shall start coming back, but...
And I've wound up debates against John, and I can't go to sleep when I wound up a debate. The adrenaline gets going, and I've left debates, and the driver's driven to Ronnie's when I left the house. He knew I wasn't going to go home, and he's dropped me off here, and I've spent the night unwinding and relaxing.
Hey, have you closed any more hospitals down?
Not in your patch, but good to see you on neutral ground.
John, we've been talking about interest in jazz and so on.
Now, I like Ken, I'd probably like to go to the second sitting, if you like, but they're never the same first or second, are they? And in that sense, if you say you go for the second, you're wondering what you've missed on the first. So I'm a one for trying to take the two sessions if I can get it and join the night people, as Ken refers to them as. Though, to be fair, I think this is the nearest we've ever sat in this club to each other.
I'm really asking you this as politicians. Jazz has traditionally had a rather anarchistic image. Do you think it's losing that?
I don't think it is losing that. I think the MJQ was saved by having a great vibes player, who, even in a dinner jacket and being schooled by the others, was still a great vibes player. But it was never my favourite setting for jazz, never my favourite group. And I think all the time what happens, the people who emerge in jazz tend to be... not exactly alternative society, but they are rebellious, they're distinctive, they're personal. It is a very personal music.
And jazz is classless. Jazz isn't class, you know, classical music in a way is part of our social structure of class, quite frankly. But jazz isn't. And I think it's because of that people tend to look down on it. It doesn't get a good opportunity to have it expressed. And, you know, that's something I just feel we should do more about. Jazz is about rebellion.
We have all these young black players coming out of South London. I mean, I still don't know whether Courtney Pine is as good as they say he is, because I've still never caught him live. But that is coming out of a slightly alternative background. And I go in the States when I'm over there, and it hasn't become really respectable. And Ronnie's has become a fashionable place. But dare I say it, I mean, John and I don't come here because we think it's become totally respectable.
But you do think that what they're doing here still means something to people of your age and for generations of jazz players?
Oh, yeah, I mean, I really respect what they're doing because there's no other place like it. You know, I mean, there's a lot of clubs that are opening now just to make money out of what Ronnie Scott's is doing, which is wrong. But Ronnie Scott's, they want to help jazz music, you know.
We'll be right back.
Current young musicians like teenager Nigel Hitchcock have come up on the crest of the 1980s jazz revival. A renewed interest in the music in this decade that's been reflected in clubs, record stores, even advertisements for perfume. They've brought a new audience to Ronnie Scott's, but young fans have also come to hear the surviving jazz giants of their parents' or even their grandparents' generation. Of course, a lot of other London jazz clubs have been run for love over the years, and they've all helped to build a base for this remarkable music in a culture sometimes aggressively ignorant of it. But Ronnie Scott's enabled British fans and musicians to hear the creators and originators of jazz at close range. The place isn't always comfortable, the food wouldn't win prizes, the staff don't kiss your feet, and the backstage ambience sometimes reminds you that jazz hasn't yet stopped being a man's world. But the club's 30 years of survival has been an achievement against all the odds.
A place like Ronnie Scott's is the equivalent of so many different things in classical music. It's a recital hall, it's a concert hall, it's a place of learning, and it takes such an important place, and you think, how can a club in Soho really be important to creativity and the serious artistic aspirations of a country? But I think that Ronnie Scott's is. I think if you agree with the subsidy of the arts, that Ronnie Scott's should be subsidised to the extent that wouldn't spoil it and make it feel as if it were on hallowed ground. But I do think that the future of a place like Ronnie Scott's, and there is only one place like Ronnie Scott's, and that's Ronnie Scott's, should be assured.
You list this place in Who's Who as your club. What is it that's special about it to you?
I mean, it's two things. I think, A, it's the policy. That for 30 years, the policy has been to build outwards from the music. And in these days of sort of designer design, I mean, God help us, one of those design consultants got in here to say, advise them on how they're packaging their product and all that stuff, it would be death. And basically, I think I identify with what Ronnie books the kind of music he likes to listen to, and by the same token, I write the kind of plays I would want to look at, and that's a very basic, almost primitive, peasant-like attitude, and that I adore, the fact that music comes first. It's the only place you can come where the proprietor advises you not to eat the food. I mean, I love all that stuff. Plus, I love the kind of ambience, because you do come for an ambience, and I mean, hence the hat. Well, one of our kids bought me the hat saying, you need this hat to go to Ronnie's, and it reflects a kind of attitude from their generation to my generation on how they think I should look to come to a place like this, if you see what I mean, that the notion of baggy eyes and a world-weary, gently sardonic guy who would walk down the mean street and not be afraid because I've heard the blues at midnight, which is absolute bollocks, you see. But it's sort of amiable, congenial, and quite harmless. I mean, what I am is a little bald guy who writes plays, but I come here and I can enter into another slightly dream world. One thing that would destroy this place would be if you hit a hole in the wall and the sunshine got in. I mean, this is not a place for sunshine. This is strictly under the stone territory.
Yeah, one says, what's your day job?
What do you do during the day?
No, I guess personally, never foresaw it going this time at all. And
like a prison sentence, really.
We're just going to go on.
30 years in a jazz club.
Yeah, when we first started, we had no ambitions at all, really. It was just a place for you know, for local guys to play. And here we are 30 years later.
It's now become of world repute. And I guess in a way we're very proud of it. Still employing lots of guys, lots of good music coming out.
Yeah, it is amazing. I mean, it's much easier to name the people that haven't played, the musicians that haven't played here, rather than the ones that have.
One week didn't get Duke Ellington.
John Coltrane, never got Charlie Parker. But there have been some marvellous nights at the place, some great nights.
I must make an apology, because the only time I sing this song is when I play England. It never became a hit anywhere else. Every time we say goodbye, I cry a little. Every time we say goodbye, I wanna watch a little. Why the gods above me, who may be the Lord, think so little of me, they allow you. Such an air of spring about it. I can hear a lark somewhere begin to sing about it.